everybody, and welcome to another exciting, fun-filled, expeditious episode of Radiorama, where, as I show you, as the name entails, we work on radios. And today we have a RCA 813K. Big husky fella. I actually have one of these in my own collection. It's one of my favorite 1940s. Well, actually, I don't think it's 40s. I can't remember the year. Like 37 or 38 is when it was just made. It's very machine age. Pretty upper end model for RCA. There was maybe two or three models above this one, but these probably, well, in fact, I know they sound wonderful. It's a 13 tube chassis with push-pull audio, and I'm trying to remember, are they 6V6 or 6F6 output tubes? Let's look here. 6F6. Kissing cousins to the 6V6. In fact, you could throw a 6V6 in there and it would work just fine. It has the magic radio brain. Also has an audio connection here. It says, an inexpensive model, R93A, attached here will make a fine phonograph. Anyway, it's the story is that this was bought by the owner's father, and they listened to it for many years, and according to him, one day someone got shocked. Now, I'm not sure how that could have been. Either the cord was rotten, which it is certainly rotten. Another possibility is this is a major switch here in the back, and you can see how it's exposed. It wouldn't be hard for someone to touch both of those things and get a little bit of a jolt. When this model was new, it actually had a piece of plywood that folded and made kind of a sealed cabinet for the speaker. So you got a little bit more bass response. It looks like it's missing. It's probably been gone for many years. Still should sound amazing. I've been putting off working on this guy, but my parents are flying in to see us for Christmas, which is in about 2 weeks. And my garage is filled up with crap. I need to... This is our old oven. I love the design, but it just wasn't getting up to temperature, so my wife finally convinced me to get a new oven, so I did. I'm trying to give this oven away. I fixed this console stereo for a friend. I'm waiting for him to come pick it up. And I got these three radios here. This one's already been restored. So what I'm hoping to do is clean and clear everything out of this garage, so I don't want my parents to come and be like, you're a hoarder! Because I probably am at this point. Anyway, I'm not going to power it up. I'm going to remove the chassis and take a looky-loo inside. I'm trying to remember. I think that was filled with dread when I took a look at mine. I believe it has the awful pre-war rotten rubber insulated wire. All right, so I got the chassis out. This is a freaking heavy chassis. I mean, it's like built like a tank. Seeing something here that doesn't make me happy. I get a feeling those are top mounted paper caps dipped in tar. I think they're usually in the tone control circuit. Maybe I'm wrong, I can't remember. It's been a long time since I worked on one of these models, probably about 7 or 8 years. Let's see, this is the electric tuning motor. It's still loose. That's good. The way you'd set these guys is you push down on this and use a screwdriver to push in those slots to reposition. I never bothered with mine because I kind of don't care. There's a plate that's basically holding the bottom together, so we need to take that off so we can take a look underneath. Bare minimum, I see on top of here we have three electrolytic capacitors. This thing is probably full of capacitors. It's interesting because we have a lot of what looks like probably original RCA tubes. One, two, three. In fact, tongue saw. Well, There's some replacement tubes in here. In fact, it looks like both of these guys were replaced. What does that say? Anderson Radio, 450. Western Ave, Los Angeles, California. Huh. Makes me wonder, did it come to Northern California at some point? Maybe the owner knows. Anyway, I'm going to flip it over to remove the bottom and see what's going underneath there. Well, it's not as bad as I remember it being, actually. Plenty of room to work in. And we have a decent amount of capacitors, not an overwhelming amount. This 1930s era of RCA, they would kind of like have these generically printed caps. When you read them this way, 0.25 microfarads, 300 working volts, and so on. And so how many do we have here? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 caps. And think, well, the only one that looks like is a real pain in the butt is this one right here. But I could rectify that problem. That other end's going to chassis ground, so I'll just find another ground close by. We have an electrolytic here that's 10 microfarad, and this guy here, I bet it's an electrolytic too, because it has that same exact look as this guy does. Probably another 10 microfarads. Here comes the creepy ice cream truck. Anyway, Mr. Softy, it comes around our neighborhood about once a day, and I can't imagine anyone wants any ice cream right now, seeing as how it's like 55 degrees out there. Anyway, I'll need to find out what the value of these guys are. And I need to pull up this schematic. I don't think that is a capacitor block there. Alright, well, I'm going to go ahead and start. I'm going to start by replacing all the electrolytic capacitors. This guy is also an electrolytic capacitor. It's 20 microfarads. And this is, I believe, 16 microfarads. And the rest of these are like 20-something microfarads. It's not, these guys, the values are not critical as far as putting in a higher microfarad rating. Like, I'm going to put 40s here. This is coming off the rectifier. This is a little more critical, so this will be replaced with a 22 microfarad cap. And observe that this is a floating ground here. There's a rubber or plastic disc underneath that capacitor. And so this is a floating ground. That's real important. If you don't do it right, you're going to get an awful sound. I also did confirm this big box up here. That is a transformer. So I don't need to worry about that guy. It's fine. I've never seen this style of capacitor before. It's clearly a mica cap. It's housed inside of plastic. Interesting. I've never seen that before. Oh well. So yeah, I'm going to go ahead and start with the electrolytics and get some of these other critical caps, and then we'll do an initial fire up test to see, oh yeah, and replace the rotten power cord to see if we get any sort of action out of it. Alright, I've done the bare minimum here. I've replaced all of the electrolytics and a few of the caps, and I put in a new cord here. It's interesting. The cords came off the Singer sewing machine. More than adequate to power a radio. So I think I'm going to bring it over to the cabinet, plug in the speaker, and see what happens. Okay, so I've got isolation transformer and variac plugged in. Let's see, is it on? On volume. Let's turn it down a little bit. Band. All right. Let's fire it up. Started at 50% to see if at least we have something like a filament. I don't see any of the lights illuminating. That's not a good sign. Okay, let's bring it up. Maybe just a little bit more. Okay, we have lights there actually, so maybe the pilot lights are burned out. That's about 70%. Oh, wait, you know what? Fuck. I forgot to put the speaker in. All right, let me try that. Okay, let's try this again. Do we have power? No, we turned the power off. All right. Turn the volume down. Where's the volume? This is so dirty, I can't see what controls which. Okay, let's give it a little more juice. Getting no sound. Zilch. That rectifier. Is that the rectifier? What is that? Let me look here. 6F6. Doesn't seem to be lighting. Rectifier is cool to the touch. I'm getting just a slight hum from the speaker. Got another tube up here that does not seem to be illuminating. I just have some loose tube sockets. I can't tell. Standard broadcast. Why is standard broadcast skipping? That should be illuminating. Maybe that's it. Have audio. Manual tuning. Okay, rectifier is now warm. All right, well, we have power, but we have no radio. Could be a lot of different things. Bad tube, bad connection, bad capacitors, bad resistor. But at least we have power, and things are starting to come alive. That tube does feel a little warm. I think that one's okay, maybe okay. This tube up here is ice cold. And what are you? This thing is so filthy. 6H6. That's a dual diode, I believe. I'm trying to think. 6H6. Isn't this one of those weird hat tubes? Anyway, I'll go look at my collection. The 6H tube was definitely bad. But I'm getting no reception. Combination of a bunch of different things. Basically, dirty contacts, possibly another bad tube. No matter. Like I said, incremental steps. Okay, so all the tubes tested good. This grid cap was loose. I'm sorry I'm having to yell over my washing machine over there. So what I'm going to do now is flip it over and clean the contacts and look for anything else that might be obvious and take it back over and test it again. If it doesn't work after that, then I think it's going to be a matter of just gradually recapping it and testing as I go. A lot of these wires here, and now the washing machine's decided to quiet down. A lot of these leads here are possibly touching metal on metal because the rubber insulation is coming off. I'll probably have to replace all of that, all the grid cap wiring at some point. This thing is absolutely encrusted with mouse shit. Like, it clearly was somebody where there were varmints. It's kind of annoying. Okay, let's try this again. I don't suspect it'll be much of an improvement. Let's see, did it actually turn on? Oh yeah, it'd help if I actually plug the plug in. Alright, now we got lights. And I replaced a light bulb that I think was burned out on broadcast.
Jesus.
A major winter storm is weekend and contract and a contract for the California Medicaid program. Enrollment in Anthem Blue Cross partnership depends on contract renewal. Anthem Blue Cross. It's the post-menopausal women.
All right, it's working. Obviously, the contacts are still filthy. We've got 90% of the original capacitors in there. It's not been realigned or anything like that, but it has life, which is much better than I could say about yesterday. It's interesting, the tubes all had RCA paper labels on them, and they all tested very good. I don't know how much radio was used, but it seems like the tubes were treated pretty gently. All right, it's time to get up to my elbows and capacitors. Quite a few here. They're all pretty clearly marked. That says 0.5 microfarads, 150 volts, 0.1 microfarads, 200 volts, 0.05 microfarads, 200 volts, and so on. Now, when it comes to the crumbly wiring, my rule of thumb is generally if it's undisturbed and it's not like exactly high tension, and I leave it alone. If it's damaged, then you got to replace it. I'm going to replace this because I don't like how that's all twisted together like that. That is the high fidelity control, and it's interesting because I'm noticing it's coming off of one of the IF transformers. I've seen that before. I've seen it done in some of the 1950s German sets to control tone. I'm not a engineer, so I'm not sure why that is or how it works, but I've seen it before. So I've already started to grab capacitors, and I use modern yellow caps. I just, by default, get some that are rated at 630 volts. Doesn't make that much difference in cost. It's good insurance. And so what I tend to do is I'll just snip one end of the old cap and then solder in one side of the new cap, snip the other side, and do the same thing. And that way you don't lose your place. Now, if you lose your place, this has a really good schematic. In fact, it's got a schematic, it's got a wiring diagram, it's got a parts list, it's got an alignment sheet, and it's even got a rewiring, well, a cord, tuning cord diagram. So I'm all good if I get lost, but this is pretty straightforward. Replacing caps is something that eats up most of my time. So, and like I said, I want to get this thing done. So here we go. All right, here's a late update. Worked on it last night and today, and first of all, I cleaned up the chassis a little bit. I'm not going to flip it over right now, but I recapped all of it, 100% of it. And then I wanted to clean all the controls here, so I took the front panel off. And also what I did is I have all new grid cap wires for all the tubes that needed them. I also replaced a lot of the wiring underneath. You'll see that when I flip it over. But right now I want to make sure and oil everything in this, all the little bearings, including this motor. This is the electric tuning motor. Seems like it's actually working pretty loosely. All you need to do is just, I add something called tri-flow to the bearing. It's this product, usually used for bicycles, it's a real fine lubricant. And I just want to get it all in there. Yeah, that's coming quite loose. I'm hoping, see what usually happens on these models is that this tiny little gear strips out. And usually it happens when the tuning mechanism itself freezes up. But I think we're in pretty good shape here. Let's see. I think there's a cog that basically engages electric tuning. It's this guy right here. Yep, you can see we'll throw that gear into the mix. All right. I'm also going to go ahead and place a few of these bulbs or maybe clean them up. That one's definitely burned out. This attaches to the side of the dial glass plate. Okay, so I've done as much as I can on the chassis. All the caps are replaced.
I gotta remember to bring my pumpkin pie next week.
Yeah, you do that. Bring your pumpkin pie. Anyway, I have the audio cable running through. That'll connect to the record player connection, which is right here. I've cleaned all the pots obsessively with deoxit. Stuff's been around forever. And I checked the output and rectifier tube, and the rectifier tube was semi-shorting. One of the output tubes was weak, so I replaced both of those. I don't have the speaker with me. Oh yeah, here, I installed a safety fuse. This goes one end of the line so that something goes haywire with the transformer. This will go first before the transformer smokes your house out. Unpleasant. I've had it happen before, and the smell lingers forever. So I've done as much as I can without the speaker, and I've got other things to do, so I'm going to put it back in the truck. Because it's not raining right now, and then we'll give it a test either today or tomorrow. Okay, I am back at the house with the chassis. I'm gonna start working on the cabinet. The cabinet, the owner understands the cabinet probably is almost too far gone and it would need a refinish, which I don't think he's interested in doing. He told us he always remembers it being kind of a little rough looking, but I think I can bring it back partially. It's going to take probably a couple nights. What I'm going to do is soak the living crap out of this with Old English. Let's make it wet with Old English, and that'll saturate into the wood and hopefully bring back some of the coloration, cover up some of the scratches. I don't know. I've started with some of these guys and they looked terrible, and I was able to bring them back to pretty good, so maybe I'll get lucky on this one too. All right, I'm going to start off with Hairds. It doesn't say Howard's, it says Howard. Anyway, don't have a lot of it left, but I don't have a lot of anything left. I think I'm going to have to pour everything on it. But, observe, that's probably way more than I should put on there. You can see how much that changes the appearance of things. Radio has a very interesting story. Anyway, I'm not going to tell the story of it because it's someone else's radio, but it's fascinating. All right, you get the idea. I'm going to go over the whole thing with it. Already a big improvement. That stuff just soaked right in. I found that doing these when they lay down like this is a lot easier on my back instead of them standing up. Anyway, I am going to now go with the Old English. I don't know what they call it that. It's not English, it's made in Pennsylvania or something like that. It's not old. And it's not malt liquor. It's in the back of the shitty gas station either. All right, well, that's starting to look better. I just absolutely saturated this thing in Old English. And I think one of these I'm going to stand it up and work on the top a little bit more. And then I'm possibly going to apply a little beeswax. Maybe I won't. What I want is all that color to seep into that wood grain. And I think I might be able to wax this guy. I wasn't going to do it originally, but I think I can. Unfortunately, my mechanical buffer, the wheel, is worn off, so I have to buy another one if I'm going to do that. All right, so everything's now doing electrically. I have my audio input thing here. By the way, don't do this if this is a hot chassis set. If you got a transformer, then you're electrically isolated. If it's a floating or hot chassis, don't do this because you could get shocked. Anyway, I think I'm going to leave the bottom off, and maybe tomorrow I'll start working on waxing this guy. But it's basically got to sit and soak for a night. All right, welcome back to day number 3 of working on the big RCA. And I went to Home Depot this morning to get a replacement buffer pad for my usual buffer, and they didn't have any, so I'm going to try this. It's a series of pads that you can use on your drill. So I'm going to use some Carnauba car wax. I find that Meguiar's works really well for me. It's just plain old-fashioned Carnauba wax, but it does the trick. Now what I'm going to do here is go over the whole thing with Carnauba wax, and what that'll do is it'll gently remove dirt and grime and return, hopefully, a lot of the gloss, because these were glossy when they were new from the factory. A lot of people don't believe that, but they were. And with time and age, you'll develop kind of a more satin-like buffed finish. But I'm going to bring this back as close as I can. You'd be surprised how much you can bring back a worn-out finish just with waxing. Well, color me surprised. That little buffer does a much better job than the big one. I think it's because you're kind of able to concentrate your scrubbing power, plus it's rotating at higher speed, so it's quicker. That's after just 2 applications. I usually have to put 5 on, but this looks pretty good. I'll probably stand the radio up and work some more on the face here because my back's starting to hurt, and then I'm gonna cross my fingers that this thing still works. I tested it out after a partial recap 2 days ago, and I just went for broke and redid all the capacitors and the electronics. I mean, I think it should be just fine, but like I said, fingers crossed. All right, so it turned out quite snazzy. Like I said, you'd be amazed how much you can save the finish, because, you know, most people would probably have taken a look at this and said to themselves, I need to strip it down. You know, this is what I prefer. Granted, it's got nicks and scratches and scrapes and stuff, but something's been on the planet for 3/4 of a century or more, it's gonna look old. And I don't know, some people have mixed feelings about it. You strip this down, you've removed all that patina. It'll never come back. So it's a personal decision that everyone can make, and there's no real wrong answer. It's your radio, your preference, but this is my personal preference. I try to keep the finish original if I can help it. Okay, there's good news and bad news. Good news is it works. Bad news is the speaker is rubbing. It's not the end of the world. Sometimes you can adjust the cones a little bit. I'm not sure about this guy. In fact, mine did the same exact thing. Like, it too literally had a rubbing cone. It just adds a whole layer of complexity here. We do have some field coil speakers at the museum. I can measure what the field coil situation is here. I think on mine too, I actually removed the output trans. You know what? That just gives me an idea. I'm just thinking here for a minute. No, I have to have the field coil on it. Never mind that. I'm just had a brain fart. Now, you can loosen this a little bit and try adjusting the cone. I'm going to take it off. I just want to make sure it's actually blown and it's not something else, like something electrically happening. All right, the cone is definitely rubbing. But what's interesting is I was looking, and the entire spider's come loose. See that? That is probably why this thing went off center. So there is a way to fix this, and what that's going to entail is removing this dust cap. And what I'm going to do before I do anything is put little shims of paper all around the core. And that should realign it, and then I'll re-glue the spider base down. This happened on my other one too, and I wasn't able to fix it. So I'm going to try to fix this first. If not, force them down to where so I can measure the field coil and see if we have any field coil speakers at the museum that'll work. We have a ton of them over there. So first thing I'm going to do is gently pull this out. I think you're supposed to use acetone to get it out, but I don't have any, so I'm going to have to gingerly pull it out just by peeling it off. Okay, now what I do, I'm going to loosen this bolt. There's two of these. I was able to pull the dust cap off really cleanly. And then I'm going to start shoving in shims of paper. Cut little pieces of paper out of, typing paper, the thin stuff. And you want to round the edges on when you push them in. I'll show you what I mean. I know that makes no sense, but I hope I can save this thing. It'll be a lot less work. Okay, I've got everything loosened up here. You can see that's wiggling around a little bit. So what I'm going to do is cut out my pieces of paper. And what we're going to do is completely line that gap with paper so that it'll be completely, perfectly centered. Then we'll glue down the spider and tighten the bolts and see if it's centered. Then we'll pull the shims out. All right, so we got our shims in place. The cone should be centered. Now it's time to start gluing the spider back together, which is going to be kind of an interesting thing. I think what I have to do is dab glue on a screwdriver and push it in there. It's not going to be, it's hard to get at too. It's really in there. Okay, everything's glued up. Even the surround was coming loose, so I had to glue that back down. I reshimmed everything, glued this down. Doesn't seem to be rubbing. We'll not know until we put it back in the radio and see what happens. Sounding a whole heck of a lot better. I'm gonna try another song that has a lot of bass in it. I think I'll take it. Nice not having to go to the dig for speakers and stick with the original. Makes my life easier. Usually I can't center these damn things, but I worked this time. All right. We are rocking and rolling. Sounds pretty damn good, in my opinion. Anyway, I'm gonna let this puppy play probably for the rest of the day. I wanna make sure that nothing is gonna overheat. Nothing's gonna fail. Yeah, that transformer's ice cold. I think we're in good shape there. I'm very happy I got that speaker working. Anyway, the electric tuning works too. So for example, observe. Electric tuning off manual. And then electric tuning on. remote or something. What happened to my motor here? Actually, I'll have to figure that out. All right, I was able to figure it out. Seems to be working pretty good now. There we go. Anyway, kind of a hokey, stupid feature anyway. I'd suggest the owner keep it on manual. It's just easier to control. And the clouds are coming in. So, we'll probably have to put the bolts back in this guy and put it back inside. All right, well, I believe that's it for this episode of Radiorama. Hope you guys learned a thing or two, or maybe you didn't, or maybe you got to be entertained by some of my stupid typical mistakes. But this is going to go back to the original owner, and hopefully that'll make him a very happy person, and he'll get many good years of use out of it. I'm happy when we fix something that's been in the family for a long time. It's more like an heirloom piece than anything. All right, guys, thanks so much for watching. Until next time a radio comes across the workbench, I'll see you guys next time. Adios.